Welcome to the class. We'll be starting with a new chapter, and that is occupational health. Occupational health is defined as promotion and maintenance of highest degree of physical, mental and social well-being of workers and prevention among workers' departure from health. Protection of workers in their employment from risk resulting from risk factors which are adverse to health. So basically this is the definition of occupational health. Long story short, preventing disease in workers and promoting health in them is basically what occupational health is. So, protection of the workers from occupational hazards is occupational health. Monitoring their health, keeping an eye on their health, regular health checkups, prompt remedial actions is occupational health. So, if you have an employee has got lots of protection from the employer, and that is basically what occupational health is. Placing and maintenance of worker in an occupational environment adapted to his physiological and psychological profile is also the domain of occupational health, and we call it as adaptation of work to man and each man to his job. Like we said, there is no disability, everyone is differently abled and everyone therefore is employable, but you need to suit jobs for that person. Similarly, occupational health says physiologically and psychologically people have traits, and if placed in those particular traits which the job demands, they can excel, and that is what we endeavor to do in occupational health. Occupational health is the application of preventive medicine in all places of employment. Occupational environment is the sum of external conditions and influences which prevail at the place of work and have a bearing on the health of the working population. Again, occupational environment is the place where the person works and everything surrounding that place which directly or indirectly affects the health of the employee. Occupational diseases are thus defined as diseases arising out of or in the course of employment. This is a very vague definition. What does the definition of occupational disease say? The disease which are arising out of or in the course of employment, which means either as a direct outshoot of the employer activity or in the course of it. So while the employee is working, a disease occurs, that also is included in this definition of occupational diseases. Occupational diseases are due to various reasons. Diseases due to physical agents, chemical agents, and there's a big list, but we will be seeing the important diseases and their characteristics. So first on the list is diseases due to physical agents. The first physical agent which comes to our mind is heat. Heat causes heat hyperpyrexia, heat stroke, heat syncope. We had seen that. Heat cramps, and it can also obviously cause burns. The Indian Factories Act has not laid down any criteria for temperature. So you can't complain that your employer has not put on an AC because there is no criteria according to the Indian Factories Act. However, work done in Indian research or Indian researchers show that in India, 20 to 27% is the comfort zone. So the temperature of 20 to 27 degrees centigrade is the comfort zone, and above 27 degrees centigrade, it gets uncomfortable. So above this, you don't want this. You want to be in the comfort zone, and the comfort zone is at 20 to 27 degrees centigrade. The next parameter is cold. Cold can cause chilblains, it can cause erythrocynosis, immersion foot, frostbite, trench foot, and general hypothermia is not uncommon. These initial things are local effects. General hypothermia is when the core body temperature drops really, really down. The condition that you have is called as general hypothermia. The rest of it are localized effects of cold. Light, you have effect of poor illumination, you already saw. There is eye fatigue, there is loss of concentration, there is decreased productivity, there can be headache, there can be eye pain, there can be lacrimation, congestion in the eyes. These are the long list of effects that can have because of low light. Chronic effects are miner's nystagmus. I hope all of you know what nystagmus is. It is the motion of the eyeball. So when your eyeballs move either horizontally or vertically, that is called as nystagmus. So you can have a horizontal nystagmus or a vertical nystagmus. Glare. Glare is defined as excessive light. You say this when my goggle cuts out glare. So what you mean to say is my goggle cuts out excessive light. When I drive, I don't feel glare, which means excessive presence of light at a particular moment is not there. So what happens if you are glare? You have discomfort, you have annoyance, and also you have visual fatigue because of glare. Some occupations also make the person prone to occupational cataract. For example, farmers. Ultraviolet radiation is a known risk factor for cataract development, and since farmers are working all day long outside, they are prone for occupational cataracts. The next physical parameter is vibration. The vibration frequencies of 10 to 500 Hz are encountered in routine work with the pneumatic drills. Those guys with those yellow hats and doing holes on the road with the pneumatic equipment, that is the equipment we are talking about. These frequencies are also found in a lot of other equipments which vibrate. They affect the arms and the hands most. What they do is that they sensitize the small arterioles in the hands vibration, and therefore these arterioles go into spasm and can cause a disease which is called as white fingers. So fine blood vessels of the fingers may become increasingly sensitive to spasm, causing white fingers, and that spasm can be really, really severe. Injuries to the joints of hands, elbows and shoulders are other associated injuries which can be caused with vibration. Ultraviolet rays occurs mainly in people who do welding. You have seen those masked men, that Iron Man helmet, and they do welding. That Iron Man helmet is basically there to protect against the ultraviolet radiation. It affects the eyes and causes intense conjunctivitis and keratitis. This intense conjunctivitis and keratitis is also called by the name of welder's flash. Clinical features are redness of the eye and pain in the eyes. Fortunately, this is a temporary phenomenon and it completely goes away. There are no permanent side effects for the internal ocular structures. The next physical parameter we are going to see is pressure. You know that there is something called as a Caisson's disease. You have studied that physiology. When you rapidly come up to the surface from below, what happens is that dissolved nitrogen, which is dissolved in the tissues, start again bubbling out, and that bubbles come into the blood circulation and they block the arterioles. And when that happens, you have severe pain. It is also called as bends. So pressure can cause Caisson's disease, air embolism, and pressure can also cause a blast. Noise, you have occupational deafness and the other side effects of noise that we saw, auditory and non-auditory. Auditory again permanent and temporary. Effects of radiation, you have cancer, leukemia, aplastic anemia, pancytopenia, radiation sickness, all those diseases that we saw. Mechanical, you can have injuries and accidents, and you can have burns with electricity. So this is a general list of what diseases can be caused under occupational setting with physical agents. Next we go on to diseases due to chemical agents. You have basically a lot of chemicals, a lot of disease. Mostly chemicals cause your skin cancer and they can cause dermatitis. The dusts are also an important part of chemicals. What we are going to see basically is the diseases caused by dust, because like the previous chapter, I had given you some highlights of that chapter. For those of you who have been educated here, you already know that pneumoconiosis is the thing to play with here. And for those of you who don't know, we are starting with it now. Dusts are inorganic and organic dusts. Now what is this inorganic and organic dust? Organic means carbon containing organic. Maybe it comes from a living thing. So organic dusts are basically well tolerated relatively, because ultimately what happens is if you ingest organic matter, it is decomposed, it slowly goes into the blood vessels and it is then taken away from the site of deposition. Whereas inorganic stuff, this simply cannot happen. If you take asbestos inside, there is no pathway in the body to digest asbestos or take it away. Body is not meant to eat asbestos or to eat iron. Particulate iron can be eatable in form of tablets, but then you don't expect the body to have iron pellets. So inorganic dusts are generally more bad, and organic dusts are not healthy, but then organic, we have something that we can do about those organic dusts. Inorganic dusts are, example, coal dust causes anthracosis, silica causes silicosis, asbestos can cause asbestosis, and it can cause cancer. It can cause lung cancer, it can cause stomach cancer, It can cause mesothelioma, that is a pleural or a peritoneal cancer. So it can cause a lot of cancers. Iron causes a disease which is called as siderosis. By your knowledge of pathology, you already know that it is called as siderosis. Organic dust, cane fiber causes bagasosis, cotton fiber causes bisinosis, tobacco causes tobaccosis, and hay or grain causes farmer's lung. We'll be seeing this list again with a few additions. Diseases due to biological agents, so you have anthrax, you have a couple of other organisms which are prone occupationally. Another example would be tetanus. Occupational cancers and dermatitis, I told you, chemical exposure usually causes dermatitis and in many cases causes skin cancer. Diseases due to psychological factors. We saw that mental health was important. My friends, what they say about me is important. My seniors, what they say about me is important. So that comes under the purview of psychological health. How is the environment surrounding me? What are the incentives that I get at my workplace? What are my expectations from my job? How is my employer treating me? And how are my colleagues treating me? Am I getting my promotions? Am I getting my salary? So all these things are under the purview of psychological factors. As far as occupational cancers goes, there is an interesting thing that you would like to know. It is this scrotal cancer in chimney cleaning boys which started the whole momentum of the occupational health per se. So that was when it was recognized that okay, certain occupations are high risk for certain diseases, and it was later observed that the chimney had soot which was rubbed against the scrotum of the kids who cleaned it, and they got scrotal cancer. So that was the one of the very first things to be observed, and the whole momentum then started going towards occupational health. Coming to ergonomics, at our level we are not really interested in going into the very depths of ergonomics, but you should definitely know what ergonomics is and what it is used for. The literal split of the word is ergon, which is a Greek word for work, and nomos means law. So literally ergonomics means laws for work. In a nutshell, what ergonomics is, fitting the job to the worker. Rather than fitting the worker to the job, let me make it the other way around. If I have a worker, let me try to fit the job to the worker. So that is ergonomics. So making the job comfortable for the worker so that he does not have to leave his job. Also minimizing accidents, decreasing health hazards, increasing his health. These are all the things that we do under ergonomics. We had discussed a small example of ergonomics earlier also. If you remember, we had discussed the jet trigger for the missile. So that missile's trigger is protected. That was an example of ergonomics, reducing accidents. Similarly, you have these ergonomic keyboards these days for people who use the computers a lot. That is another example of an ergonomic design which minimizes the trauma that you have for your fingers and your hands while you work on the computers. So these are some of the examples of ergonomics. Obviously, it's a very big science, but these are the highlights that you should at least know. Ergonomics involves designing of machines. It also involves designing of tools and equipments and layout of places of work. One thing that comes to my mind is that equipment that you use to open bolts, that locks when you open it and then you can move it back, again it opens. So that is a very good ergonomic design. I don't have to take it out again, try to unbolt it. It locks at its place, I can take it back and then again start. So these small innovations help us in a long way, and these innovations are done because of a science which is called as ergonomics. In order to achieve greater efficiency of both man and machine, the object of ergonomics is to achieve the best mutual adjustment between man and his employment or his work for the improvement of human efficiency and well-being, so that you can easily do your job and you are not exposed to the risk factors. It has tremendously helped to reduce accidents, that goes without saying. Ergonomics is an ongoing science. Say for example, you have a work assembly. If you have ever seen supercars, they show a wonderful assembly. The workers really don't have to move around, they don't have to run around. Even if they have to fit something under the car, the whole car moves upside down and they have their work area in front of them. They don't slide under the cars and try to fit those small parts in awkward positions. That is not done. So this is then ergonomics. Facilitating the work for the employee is ergonomics. If you have a question on this, it would not be a difficult question to spot. But then remember that this whole science is called as ergonomics. Coming to the important topic in occupational health, we were talking about the pneumoconiosis. Pneumoconiosis is a umbrella diagnosis. Pneumoconiosis basically says that you have a lung disease because of inhalation of particulate matter. That is all pneumoconiosis says. So pneumoconiosis is a umbrella diagnosis. Dust within the size range of 0.5 to 5 micron after a long period causes a lung disease known as pneumoconiosis. Like we saw, that dust can be organic or it can be inorganic, both cause disease, but generically it is called as pneumoconiosis. The effects on the lung because of these chronic inhalation of this dust depend upon the chemical composition of the dust itself. So what are you inhaling? Like I said, inorganic, organic, and under that also, what are you inhaling? Hay, iron, mercury, or what? So that is chemical composition. Fineness, how fine is the dust? As you know, smaller particles directly go to the alveoli. Now the level given here is 5 micron, and that is what is mentioned, but somewhere the level is also mentioned as 3 microns. But let us stick to 5 micron. Particles less than 5 micron in size have a propensity to directly go to the alveoli. Physiology, you remember, you have nasal hairs, you have nasal mucus secretions, you have moisture, then you have moisture in the pharynx, you have warming of the air, it acts as a very good filter, all those particles are clamped down in the mucus and the hairs, and the air is cleaned, and then you take it to the lungs. Physiology, these particles beat that. Less than 5 microns, if you have the size of the particle, it simply bypasses all these defense mechanisms and directly goes to the alveoli. Alveoli, again, if you forgot your physiology, is the last thing to have in the lung. So it directly goes and deposits into the alveoli. And that is a problem because there is no cleaning mechanism there. Alveoli are basically respiratory epithelium. It is not meant to throw out stuff. So therefore, these particles less than 5 microns are the real headache which cause pneumoconiosis. Coming back to our list, the third on the list is concentration of these particles in the air. Now this is common sense. If I walk into a room, I have particles here, but I am not very much concerned because the particles are less. I have this dust of this chalk flowing around, but the concentration is less. Had this been a chalk factory, I would have been concerned because I would have been inhaling a lot of dust there. Period of exposure. How long is the exposure? Obviously, few diseases we will see, the period of exposure is very, very short. Example, siderosis. Siderosis is one such disease. If the concentration is high, if the dust is very high, siderosis happens very fast. So that is an example. Few diseases are there which take decades together to occur, otherwise they don't occur. And health status of the exposed person. We had seen the healthy worker effect. When you do a study on occupational health and employees are surveyed, it seems that they are doing tough jobs but they are having less of health problems. And that was a paradox. Healthy worker effect. What was the healthy worker effect? The guy who had problem has already left the job. He is at his home. The guy who could sustain that is working. So therefore, you do a survey and you have a strong bias there. This bias was healthy worker effect, which is exemplified in this last point, health status of the person exposed. A healthy person is going to stick into the job. If a person had a problem with the job, he has already quit. He is not working now. So health status of the person is a definitive determinant of the effect of these particles. What you have in front of you is the list that I was talking about, the extended list. Some new diseases have also been included here. We'll just read through it. Some of them are really, really difficult to remember, like silicosis is caused by silica. I don't know how you remember this. Okay, very simple. Silicosis is caused by silica. Anthracosis, yeah, this does not give me a clue. You have to remember this. Anthracosis is caused by coal dust. Anthracosis is caused by coal dust, coal. Bicinosis is caused by cotton dust. Again, does not give me a clue. Bagasosis sounds very close to bicinosis. is caused by sugarcane dust. I have a method of remembering this. I see the bag as the remaining after you take out the juice, whatever you have, you can make a bag out of it. You can make a bag out of it, and that tells me the disease it causes. The disease causes bagasosis, and it is made out of sugarcane dust. This is the way I remember. If you want it, you can also remember. What is left after you take out the sugarcane juice is just jute type material. You have jute bags. All those 5-star, 7-star resorts give you the jute bags. So that is a bag. Sugarcane dust causes bagasosis. What remains is bisinosis, and therefore it is caused by the cotton dust. Asbestosis is caused by asbestos. Very easy. Farmer's lung is caused by hay or grain dust. This is also easy. It is very much predictable. Farmers are exposed to grain dust. Farmers are exposed to hay. So farmer's lung is caused by hay or grain dust. Siderosis, everybody knows. Pathology, physiology, lot of subjects teach us. Siderosis is caused by excess of iron. This one is new. Sequiosis. It is caused by red wood saw dust. A lot of specifications there. Red wood saw dust causes sequiosis. Sugarosis is caused by moldy cork dust. Now I have figured out a way to remember this also. Sugarosis is caused by moldy cork dust. You know, there is a supercar named as Subaru. They were the champions of rally car driving initially. So if you buy a Subaru, it comes without saying that you will have to open the champagne cork, and thus the cork dust causes sugarosis. You have a disease when you have a Subaru. So Subaru, sugarosis, moldy cork dust. So you have an association there. Sugarosis, cork, champagne bottle, cork dust. Detergent workers' lung is caused by the enzyme additives which are added in the detergents, and they cause this disease called as detergent workers' lung. What these diseases are individually, we will be seeing in the next class. Thank you.